Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Thank you. Please, please be seated. Thank you very much. Good evening, Baltimore.
Good evening.
Nope. Good evening, Baltimore.
Good evening.
Thank you for being here tonight and for sharing an unparalleled commitment to our beautiful city. And let me begin tonight by thanking my partners, Council President Mosby, Comptroller Henry, the entire City Council. Even when we come down on the opposite sides of the issue, I know your dedication to our residents knows no bounds. And I also want to thank our state elected officials who are here with us this evening, who came from Annapolis and have to go back for a vote at 7 o'clock. We need them to make sure they do that. So thank you all for your partnership and for your commitment to Baltimore that you do each and every day. To the members of my cabinet and the members of city government, thank you for answering the call to make a difference in the lives of Baltimoreans every day. And lastly, to every community partner, every activist, every resident who is here tonight or maybe watching at home or on their phone, your spirit is what makes Baltimore special. Tonight, I am here for my fourth State of the City address. And I am happy to report that the state of our city is stronger and more resilient than ever. There is still so much work to do, but we must acknowledge how far we've come in just a few short years. When I gave my first State of the City address in 2021, I stood at a podium much like this one, but alone, giving this speech virtually as a deadly global pandemic continued to take its toll on our city. We had a virus to fight, vaccines to distribute, businesses to support, and lives to save from both COVID and violence. And let's be honest, both the pandemic and the epidemic had Baltimore in a chokehold. Reflecting on those moments, it's jarring to see how far Baltimore has come. Last year, we achieved the largest single year reduction in homicides Baltimore has ever seen. And we're continuing that reduction this year. We're welcoming new investments, developments and projects, new schools and rec centers, and new opportunities for all Baltimoreans. We're strengthening the parts of the city that were damaged by the pandemic, rebuilding city services, using ARPA dollars to support our most vulnerable neighbors, and reducing unemployment to the lowest level Baltimore has ever seen. Baltimore is an inflection point in our history, and each of us has the power to choose the direction we take. When I took office, Baltimore's infrastructure was broken, both literally and figuratively. We needed to tackle decades of intentional disinvestment, restore consistency and stability to city government after more than 15 years of chaos and scandal, and we had to set the stage for Baltimore's renaissance to truly take hold and flourish. We know these things take time and require us to speak hard truths, but equity, transparency, accountability, and integrity have all been at the core of our work. For me, thank you. For me, a son of Park Heights who endured the firsthand impacts of neighborhood neglect, I knew that Baltimore needed to do better, and Baltimoreans deserve better. I've always said that I want to be the mayor who laid a foundation for a new golden age in Baltimore. That has been my promise, and tonight it is easy to see the progress. When I took office, Baltimore had been grappling with spiking homicides since 2015. With the city regularly seeing more than 300 Baltimoreans killed every year. Something had to give. So we got to work, outlining and then implementing Baltimore's first ever comprehensive violence prevention plan. The first ever for Baltimore in 2021. No more disjointed strategies, failed zero tolerance policing, or half-baked diversion programs. Done with the false choice of investing in law enforcement or investing in community violence intervention. Our approach is both and it has to be. We have built a plan that supports our community violence intervention ecosystem. We established a nationally recognized 911 diversion program that resolved over 600 incidents with community-based responders rather than police and expanded our victim services work. As a young black man, I have personally seen the negative impact of misguided, disjointed approaches of the past. I've lost friends and loved ones to gun violence, to addiction, to the criminal justice system, and have been a victim of gun violence myself. But I found purpose in the movements to save lives. From leading the 300-man march and working alongside We Are Us and the many organizations who fight to make their community safer every day. Those experiences drive my commitment to this work. They ground my belief that we must continue to embrace community-centered, evidence-driven public health approaches that treat violence like the complex public health issue that it is. In 2023, we did manage to achieve the largest single year reduction in homicides that Baltimore has ever seen, reducing them by 20%. It marked the first time that we as a city had less than 300 homicides in nearly a decade. And so far this year, we're building on top of that, dropping another 21% in homicides and 12% in non-fatal shootings. But it's not enough. It will never be enough until we do not lose a single one of our neighbors to violence. However, this progress showcases that our strategy is working. Now is the time to double down. Not pull back or return to the failed, broken policies of the past. We know that much of the problem is due to the proliferation of guns on our streets. Small, everyday conflicts, Councilman Bullock, escalate into horrific violence in the presence of too many guns. We've seen it too many times, including last summer at the Brooklyn mass shooting. Alongside all of our law enforcement partners, we are going after guns in our communities, focusing on everyone from those who pull the trigger to those who supply the weapon. Last year, VPD recovered over 2,900 guns, including hundreds of ghost guns. So far, they've seized 596 guns this year, an 11% increase, including 86 ghost guns. The brave men and women of VPD, like the detectives from our group violence unit, some of whom are with us tonight, have helped take down drug trafficking organizations, like the one in Irvington, where they got illegal narcotics, firearms, and violent offenders out of that community. In the courts, we went after Paloma 80, the nation's largest ghost gun manufacturer, and secured a historic $1.2 million in damages and effectively ended their business with Maryland residents altogether. And we filed suit against the ATF to finally get full access to crime gun tracing data. Our fight is not with our partners with the ATF, who do incredible work and support BPD every single day. However, our fight is with the unconscionable T-Hart Amendment pushed by Republican members of Congress, which ties the hands of ATF and the hands of BPD, who are not allowed to share where these weapons come from with me or any other policymaker. On top of that, we're remaining focused on quality of life crimes, honing in on auto theft and bringing carjackings down 15% last year and another 5% this year. In fact, BPD's quality of life calls for service are down 18% across the board from this time last year. We are doing this the right way, not by pushing to meet quotas, not through illegal stop and frisk, and not by policing people simply because they're black. We're doing it. We're doing it with focused enforcement, while cutting illegal arrests in half, and while achieving compliance in whole sections of the consent decree for the first time in its seven-year history. Commissioner Worley, we're turning the department into one that serves Baltimore's residents the way they should have been served all along. And while many are not, we, as a city, are actively graduating police academy classes. We redistricted for the first time in 60 years, and we're finally on the verge of securing local control of our police department. That is a fight that I've led my entire time in public service since the council president and I were freshman city council members. And I encourage all of Baltimore to finalize it at the November ballot box to ensure that BPD is accountable to Baltimoreans and not folks in Western Maryland. My mayor's Office of Neighborhood Safety and Engagement under Director Mavronis continues to lead our comprehensive work. Monsey is staffed by some of the most dedicated, caring, and diligent staff in city government. Their work is changing lives and perceptions about public safety. They spearhead our work on the group violence reduction strategy led by Terrence Nash, which is a partnership with the state's attorney, the Office of the Attorney General, BPD, and myself. We leverage community moral voice partners like Derwin Hanna from Southwest Baltimore to engage directly with those responsible for driving violence. We offer them a choice directly in a letter from me. Put down the guns and let us help you change your life or face the consequences for continuing to be involved in violence. In fact, at my stepson's basketball game last Friday night, a young man came up to me and showed me a picture of the letter he received. He said he had already taken us up on our offer and is now connected to services through ROCA. We know this works. Continue now, everybody. So, thank you. We believe in everybody's right to protest, but as we always say, there's decency in order. it's a little different when you're reading from a script. We know this works, but you don't have to just believe me. Yes, we're going to get back to saving lives in Baltimore. We know this works, and you don't just have to believe me. The University of Pennsylvania's Crime and Justice Policy Lab found that the GVRS program drove a 25% reduction in homicides and non-fatal shootings, as well as a 33% reduction in carjackings in its first 18 months in the Western District. This focused deterrent strategy is succeeding where others have failed because of the buy-in from my office and our partners and the actual support we're offering those who choose to change their life. After expanding the strategy to the Central District this year, we are well on our way to completing the expansion to the Eastern District, Councilman Stokes, next month. But increasing public safety also means healing communities that have been impacted by violence. Programs like Safe Streets, We Are Us, the Peace Team, and Challenge to Change work with these high-risk individuals to mediate conflicts and shift the culture around gun violence. And Mossy's Victim Service Team does life-changing work. Their support of victims, families, and witnesses could be the difference maker for someone, like it was for Justin Wilkes, who is with us tonight, who got assistance from Mossy's team after a police-involved shooting took place in his neighborhood. With their help, he was able to get on the right path, hold down the job, and improve his mental health. Thank you, Justin. Once they work with someone, they don't just disappear. Their coordinated neighborhood stabilization response brings whole communities together to feel the full weight of our support, often for extended periods of time. Like they're doing in Brooklyn, where their continued support is still making an impact, alongside neighborhood stakeholders like the Tenant Council, faith leaders like Bishop John Watts and Pastor Billy Humphrey, and residents like Lavette Hyman, and my good friend, young Mason Conway, a budding advocate and the mayor of Brooklyn. Good to see you, Mr. Mayor. We must not slow down. There has been too much progress. I made it very clear to Deputy Mayor Barksdale, BPD, Monsey, and every single agency that falls under me that we will carry our momentum forward, because Baltimoreans' lives and the future of Baltimore are on the line. In the coming weeks, my administration will release the first biennial update of our Comprehensive Violence Prevention Plan, outlining our progress and improving our strategy. This update includes, for the first time ever, a specific youth justice pillar. A little less than a year ago, I also tasked Deputy Mayor Jurazic with convening the Youth Violence Reduction Work Group, which includes city and state agencies, community stakeholders, but most importantly, young people themselves. And earlier this month, we were informed that we are receiving a $738,000 federal earmark to support our school-based violence prevention efforts. Too often, I arrive on the scene of a homicide to find a victim or perpetrator who hasn't even gotten a chance at a full life. Those scenes, like Brooklyn Day, are the most gut-wrenching and why I can't sleep at night. No, it's not charm. As a new dad, blessed with a stepson and a brand new baby boy, the stakes are all too real for me. Our young people deserve a chance at a hopeful future, which means focusing on their safety, addressing their specific needs, and hear me when I say this, ensuring accountability when needed. From intensive case management and out-of-school time programming, we must consider the whole young person in all parts of their life. With the success of our Squeegee Collaborative, which has reduced Squeegee-related incidents by 85%, Sidestep Youth Diversion, and last year's Be More This Summer Youth Engagement Strategy, we know what works. With spring break underway, We are already proactively working on youth safety for the warmer months and are building on the lessons we learned last year. Together, we increased youth and community engagement, registering more than 3,500 young people for more than a dozen events hosted by my office throughout the summer. Young people themselves told us what they wanted to see. Teen pool parties, bringing back midnight basketball, block parties from back in the day, and launching new activities. This summer, it will all be back. But it's not just about special activations. I, like you heard from the council president, am a proud member and alum of rec centers and the access to opportunities they provided growing up. But at some point, that access changed. For years, mayors said they prioritized youth without backing that up, shutting down rec centers and defunding programs. I was determined to lead differently and show our young people they are more worth more than empty promises and shuttered doors. Gone are the days where we will balance the budget of our back on the backs of our children. We must prioritize them and put our money where our mouth is. Over the past 3 years, we've made a historic $120 million into our city rec and parks, rec centers, playgrounds, and parks. Last year, we started construction on a new Chick Webb Rec Center and a new Parkville Rec Center in West Baltimore, Councilman Torrance. This week, we'll reopen Medfield Rec. Next month, we'll break ground at Gardenville Rec. And Councilwoman Porter, later this year, we'll start on a new rec center for Brooklyn and Curtis Bay. We've installed 5 brand new playgrounds and upgraded 26 play stations throughout the city. And we're continuing our work to repair and enhance the city pools. And for a lot of these facilities, it's the first time they've been touched since the day they were built. Last year, we began construction on the Ambrose Kennedy and Walter P. Carter pools. And hear from me first, Councilman Cohen, Passion Park Pool will be open this summer. Fighting for our kids is a collective effort. And with Maryland's blueprint, I am proud to have invested more in education than any other mayor in history. Helping us make progress inside and outside the classroom. Our school CEO, Dr. Santelices, is here. I'm extremely proud that while she's had 4 mayors, I've only had 1 CEO. And despite the critics intentionally misleading about what city schools is accomplishing, I will tell you a simple truth. Our educators, our students, and our families are on the rise. Initiatives like Head Start are helping families raise healthier, happier children more likely to succeed in school. Judy Centers and City Schools Pre-K are helping our students outperform the state overall in kindergarten readiness. I would love to see that on a morning news ticker. And elementary and middle school students are making gains in English language arts. There, of course, is much work to do, particularly in math. But we're standing with city schools as they expand middle school athletics, now offering more sports than any other urban school district in the country. Closing those gaps starts with making sure schools support our students' whole development and getting there on time every day, which is why we launched the Mayor's Attendance Challenge. And already this year, daily attendance has increased year to year to 88%. And chronic absenteeism has been reduced by nearly 12% all across city schools. I want to shout out our first winners of the Mayor's Attendance Challenge, Principal Ford from Booker T. Washington, Principal Wilson from BDJ, and Principal Young from Excel Academy, who have produced some of the most pronounced increases in the district. Supporting our young people also means ensuring they have a bright future ahead. Last year, Baltimore experienced its lowest unemployment rate ever, and our city had the 8th fastest growing economy in the country. But we're harnessing all that growth so that all Baltimoreans can take part. After 50 years of giving Baltimore's young people summer jobs, YouthWorks has seen 2 back-to-back record years for applications, and everyone who applied was offered a job. Now, more than 200 young people have offers to participate in the first YouthWorks year-round cohort. Thank you, Director Garvin, and the YouthWorks team for helping make these young people's dreams a reality. But we're also recruiting at City Hall. Last month, I established the Mayor's HBCU Fellowship Program, an opportunity for recent graduates from Morgan and Cotton State to come serve the city of Baltimore in much-needed positions. They'll get work experience, career coaching, housing incentives, and competitive salaries. And we'll keep Baltimore's best talent here, working for Baltimore's community. But our opportunities are not just for college grads. Tonight, I'm announcing that on April the 25th, we will host a citywide hiring fair at the War Memorial Building. Across the city, you will hear a very simple message. Baltimore is hiring. City government offers a great opportunity to build a life, buy a home, and support a family. It is the honor of a lifetime to serve this city. Just like ask employees like Sadie Witt, who has worked at the Pratt Library for 61 years. And Ms. Joyce Dixon, an office supervisor who is with us, who has worked for BPD for 59 years. Working for the city of Baltimore is an opportunity to be a part of the bigger change we're making in city government. And after more than a decade of scandal and chaos, we're restoring trust and stability and integrity in city government. We are building a government that works for all Baltimoreans, not just the wealthy and not the well-connected that want to buy their seat at the table. The government we are building is fueled by the people that want the best for Baltimore. Neighbors like Antonio Boyd, president of the Fort Worthington Community Association, where he fights for his community every day. And my good friend, Miss Audrey Carter, who one of Baltimore's guardians, who is a long time advocate in the Oliver community. Antonio and Miss Audrey are the kind of neighbors that fuel Baltimore's progress. Here's what I know. No matter the neighborhood, Baltimoreans all want the same thing. A government that is responsive. A government that moves with a big, bold vision for the city. And a government that delivers basic city services the right way. We've doubled down on reforming our antiquated system. We're reforming the city's decades-old procurement processes. And last week, we secured a new technology to overhaul our tax system and our permitting system. Yes, you'll be able to do payment plans for taxes now. I implemented agency performance plans and actually expanded our city stat model. And with a $3 million grant, we grew our Bloomberg I team, making it the largest in the country. All of these reforms serve to make our city function better, more efficiently, and with less waste for Baltimoreans, so that we can tackle the big intractable challenges that faces our city services. As I stand here before you, we've stabilized many of the core services that were deeply impacted by years of City Hall dysfunction and a global pandemic. But nowhere is that more clear than the progress in DPW and their 2 most high-profile responsibilities, water and trash. At my last State of the City address, I made a promise to restart weekly recycling in the first quarter of 2024. And I'm proud to report that we deliver on that progress. And we did it the right way, the sustainable way, the truthful way. We grew our solid waste workforce by hiring or promoting 35 new drivers and 74 new solid waste workers, driving down the vacancy rate to the lowest level in years. They joined the ranks. They joined the ranks of many dedicated, essential workers in the Solid Waste Bureau and all of our city agencies who tirelessly do the most unglamorous and thankless work in our city. One of our crews is here tonight. Let's give them a big round of applause. For the first time ever, we put GPS in our vehicles and we no longer use paper maps. We right-sized our recycling routes. We purchased 80 new load packer trucks to modernize our fleet. And we brought back a transformational leader, Khalil Zaid, who will lead the Department of Public Works into the future. I want to thank Richard Luna, Craig Zeta, and Vaughn Moore Jackson, Burke Attila, and so many others that worked diligently to get recycling back sustainably. But we've also completed two projects that has dogged multiple former administrations. For decades, Ashburton and Druid Lake serviced Baltimore's residents being exposed to the elements and failing to meet EPA regulations. I'm proud to say that DPW teams worked around the clock to finally get it done, completing the projects last November and December, despite some persistent misinformation to the contrary. Every other administration had the opportunity, but this team had the resolve to finish the job. And this year, as we examine the recommendations of Baltimore Regional Water Task Force, we will ensure that Baltimore's water system remains Baltimore's system while improving regional governance. We've also seen incredible progress at our two wastewater treatment plants, Patapsco and Back River. Their troubled history has been a reflection of the many persistent challenges that face city services, aging infrastructure, staffing challenges, and neglect from those in charge. But we changed that. And now those plants are working better than they have in decades. And now they're putting out their best, lowest ever effluent numbers, ever. Meaning, very simply, that our water is cleaner and our communities are healthier. That progress means something. But at no point in the last 50 years has our harbor been healthier than it is now. It is swimmable most days of the year. I'm going to say it twice. It is swimmable most days of the year, Councilman Torrance. Bringing back wildlife and sea life that was thought impossible for most of my lifetime. Yes, there are crabs in the harbor and people crab in the harbor. That's what a healthy environment in our city looks like. And I expect to see each and every one of you, including the city council, alongside me, kayaking in the harbor on Waterfront Partnership's Baltimore Blue Wave this summer. Keeping our neighborhoods and city clean is a daily effort that takes not just the women and men of DPW, but every one of us. Trash, litter, and illegal dumping has plagued our city for decades. Our ARPA-funded Clean Core initiative has been a tremendous success in cleaning up our neighborhoods while empowering residents. Contrary to what some may think, this is not about supplanting DPW's work. It's leveraging community partners like neighborhood associations and nonprofits who want to serve our city. Fueled by folks like Davon Taylor, a Clean Core member who's with us tonight, who was out picking up trash in Druid Heights when he sprang into action to help save a woman from a burning building on West North Avenue last November. Thank you, Davon. Their impact is real. Removing nearly 700 tons of trash from our streets and lots. However, we must confront a harsh truth. While cleaning up is vital, it's only a part of the solution. We cannot merely clean our way out of a dumping problem. We must eradicate the root cause. Illegal dumping is not just littering. It's an offense against our community and our city's soul. When someone dumps in someone's yard, they deliver a message about what they think our residents are worth. Nothing but a pile of trash. For those who do it, be warned. Our housing department's special investigations unit continues to expand our camera network with now over 100 locations, putting eyes on the ground and catching perpetrators in the act. We're fighting in Annapolis to expand that unit's powers to identify and pursue perpetrators, like seeking driver's license photos and gathering information on social media, and we intend to shame them. But we must change the fines too. The penalty for illegal dumping in our neighborhoods cannot simply be the cost of doing business. When one individual dumps 3.6 tons of tires in Poppleton and is fined a mere $500, it's a slap on the wrist and a slap in the face of those residents. That's why I'll be calling for a charter amendment to significantly increase the maximum civil penalty for the illegal dumpers and deliver the message that our city will not be their dumping ground. Effectively handling our waste is about safeguarding our residents. We must modernize our systems and double down on proven strategies like recycling and composting to reduce incineration and landfill waste. Councilmember Conway, we were recently awarded a $4 million grant by EPA to develop a solar-powered, scalable composting facility co-located with the new Eastside Transfer Station. This is an environmental justice issue, and I know that Councilwoman Porter knows this all too well. We have communities in our city that are in the 99th percentile for asthma and in the 96th percentile for proximity to hazardous waste. Every neighborhood in Baltimore deserves to be clean, safe, and respected. This is not just about beautification. It's about health in our city. And from COVID to maternal health to heart disease to the opioid epidemic, the work of our city health department saves lives every day. Just last week, I officially swore in Dr. Muga as our new health commissioner. She is bringing her incredible wealth of experience and deep love for Baltimore to her work on behalf of our residents. In maternal and child health, we've reached a historic low infant mortality rate. Partnerships like Be More for Healthy Babies are helping us eliminate the disparities between black and white moms in targeted neighborhoods. We're protecting abortion care and access to reproductive rights in the wake of a Trump-backed Supreme Court eliminating women's rights. Last year, we granted nearly $300,000 to organizations that provide abortion and family planning services. And as long as I have a say, Baltimore will always defend reproductive rights. Always, no matter who says we should. We've also expanded our protection for Baltimore's LGBTQ+ residents. We realized the commission, and last year, we established some of the strongest anti-discrimination laws in the country. Councilmember Annette, thank you very much. Every institution that we have in Baltimore helps expand access to necessary health and social services, like the Pratt Library System, who is a national leader in this model, ensuring that Baltimore's libraries are not just a place for books, but where community connections exist. Whether it's distributing, yeah, we can clap for the Enoch Pratt. Whether it's distributing thousands of laptops in partnership with my office, or the expansion of social impact programs like Lawyer in the Library, Social Work in the Library, Wellness at Pratt, and Peer Navigators, Pratt is often the difference makers for our residents in need. As one Baltimorean put it, after Pratt, a Pratt-based social worker helped him get health insurance after returning home from prison. They are the bridge between possibilities and probabilities for our residents. That is the impact of our work, CEO Graham, and thank you very much. Our commitment to our residents extends their entire lifetime. And under my leadership, Baltimore has overwhelmingly improved how we care for our city's older adults. By establishing the Mayor's Office of Older Adults Affairs and Advocacy and getting his first ever director, Miss Andrea Harmon, confirmed. We have opened a new chapter for our seniors. This office is already connecting more seniors to services they need, like telehealth services, expanding the connection to Maryland's Access Point program, which serviced 9% more calls last year, and learning how to take advantage of programs like housing upgrades that benefit seniors and home repair grants, which enable thousands of older adults to age in place in Baltimore with the dignity and grace that they deserve. One of the most challenging, however, public health challenges our city continues to face is the opioid epidemic, killing nearly three times as many people in our city than gun violence. No one in Baltimore has escaped the impact of this crisis. And through the health department, we are deploying every resource we can, including community-based providers in our overdose spike alert responses, and recommitting funding for our mobile response van, which provides judgment-free and accessible clinical care and social services to those at risk of overdose. We're also standing up the mayor's overdose prevention cabinet and redoubling our work with partners like Behavioral Health System Baltimore, Charm City Care Connection, Baltimore Crisis Responses, Inc., and the Baltimore Harm Reduction Coalition, some of who are here tonight. Our first responders face the dire circumstances of this epidemic every day. In July of 23, we deployed the fire department's new population health unit to aid in our overdose prevention work. So far, they've distributed 6,000 Narcan kits throughout the city, contributing to a 29% reduction in overdose responses in the 30 days following their distribution in the area. Overall, between August 23 and February of this year, Baltimore has seen an 18% reduction in overdose responses compared to the same period last year. But our fire department is no stranger to risking their own lives to save others. And in the past few years, they've lost far too many. But our city and this department always rallies to support each other. And I'm proud to say that my administration has rallied to support them too. In the course of the last few years, we've invested $26 million in our aging fire fleet and apparatus, and there is more support to come. And in the next few weeks, I will announce additional investments to make long overdue improvements to fire stations, the fire academy, and safety equipment. Their work supporting Baltimore's most vulnerable residents is invaluable, and we must value them. Just the other week, we were together in Southeast Baltimore, Councilman Cohen, sitting with a family who lost three young lives in a house fire. After that tragedy, everyone mobilized. The fire department and Red Cross distributed more than 85 smoke alarms. The Mayor's Office of Immigrant Affairs and Community Partners provided translation services. And MONSI, MOCFS, and numerous other agencies deployed all of their wraparound services in that community. That was a neighborhood in need, and this administration showed up just as we do every single day. Protecting Baltimore's most vulnerable residents is a sacred responsibility. It's why you see so much focus on issues of homelessness and housing security from my administration. In just the past few months, we successfully purchased two hotels to support the efforts of Director Simmons and the Mayor's Office of Homeless Services. We're expanding our emergency shelter space, and through our housing accelerator, awarded $30 million in ARPA funds to build more permanent supportive housing in Baltimore. And we've continued our eviction prevention efforts, making Baltimore the only jurisdiction in the state of Maryland still providing active rental assistance to families. But solving the housing challenges in our city means supporting equitable neighborhood development in every way that we can. And under my administration, community is truly part of our community development. Building a better Baltimore must benefit current residents. To those of you like me who have lived in forgotten neighborhoods, I see you, and I promise that you will be here to reap the rewards. Baltimore is going to show D.C., New York, Detroit, and L.A. what it means to have development without displacement. Working with Annie Millie and with Baltimore, we rolled out Buy Back the Block, designed to assist long-term renters who want to become homeowners and stay in their neighborhoods, like me. Buy Back the Block enabled Ms. Shannon Clifton to purchase a home in her community, and over 100 other renters have been given the green light to utilize the $10,000 grant to do the same. Congratulations, Ms. Clifton. I know she's here with us tonight. Never before have we seen the types of investments flowing into our city. Thanks to President Biden and the best congressional delegation a mayor could ask for, national investments from the Infrastructure Investment and Jobs Act are bringing billions into our city for projects like the Frederick Douglass Tunnel, improvements to Penn Station, the Howard Street Tunnel, finally, and upgrades to our light rail fleet. We're also receiving federal infrastructure money for the Drew Park Lake Drive project and a Reconnecting Communities grant to begin to overcome the wrong done by the Highway to Nowhere. To ensure we are maximizing this opportunity, the Mayor's Office of Infrastructure Development, led by Matt Garbaugh, will host an infrastructure summit in May to connect small businesses with billions in infrastructure investments. They are already beacons of what charting a bright, bold city looks like. I saw a glimpse of that future last summer when Councilman Burnett and I, a black mayor, he, a black councilman, were personally out knocking doors to convince black homeowners in Emerson Village to repeal racist covenants so that a black developer could take over the long troubled Emerson Village shopping center. Now, Lanier Richardson has organized Southwest Baltimore residents to take part in co-ownership of the project. Lifelong EV resident Ms. Lachelle Bynum was understandably skeptical at first. Skeptical because for decades, city and state leaders promised Ms. Bynum and her neighbors life-changing projects without having any resources to deliver. It's easy to be discouraged when there's a history of projects like the Red Line being canceled. But we're changing that history. With a $12 million investment from the city, the long stall Uplands development is on path to completion with over 150 affordable units and affordable home ownership opportunities on the way. And across the street, the Emerson Village Shopping Center is finally headed towards redevelopment. Once the justified skeptic, Ms. Bynum joining us tonight as a proud investor in the shopping center that anchors her lifelong neighborhood. Thank you, Ms. Bynum, and all of your neighbors for joining in the effort to move our city forward for everyone. These developments are hard, and no one knows that more than my West Baltimore brother, Dave Bramble. His work with Harbor Place will breathe new life into our downtown. After it sat languishing for years, Dave and his team stepped up to finally make a change. It's not news to say that I support the plan to redevelop Harbor Place, but if this is the first you've heard of Dave Bramble's work, just know that his work in neighborhoods across Baltimore is even more inspiring. From Reservoir Hill to Greektown and Northport, projects like his are driving Baltimore's renaissance in every part of our city. Because too often in Baltimore's history, there's been a division between downtown and the rest of Baltimore. But we know our neighborhoods and downtown cannot thrive without each other. That's why we're investing in both. Like cities all across the country, our downtown is at a crossroads, and we're charting our path with Downtown Rise, a roadmap for investment, support, and equity. Whether you're coming downtown for work or to see a show at the CFG Arena, one of the top 10 grossing venues in the world, or joining the Orioles for opening day and later in the World Series. Downtown is a gathering place for all Baltimoreans, despite some who claim no one ever goes downtown. But our focus is equally on our neighborhoods. Baltimore, the birthplace of redlining, bears the scars of that history. Vacants have always been a symbol of the intentional disinvestment in our neighborhoods. Like so many of you, I've never known a Baltimore without them. They line my walk to school, surround the courts I used to play on. I saw trees growing out of vacant houses instead of lining our streets. In Park Heights, where we're famous for one day a year and forgotten every other, we knew the impact that blight could have on our neighborhood, but more importantly, on our sense of safety and hope. We all know the urgency, but for two decades, our vacant problem was stagnant, stuck at 16,000 vacants across Baltimore. We were spending hundreds of millions giving tax breaks to downtown developments, with just a fraction of that going to our most visible development problem. At that rate, we were going to take 375 years to fix the problem. And that's why, over the last 3 years, my administration has invested a historic $146 million into our neighborhoods, alongside Rebuilt Metro, Black Women Build, and so many others. That investment helped us get down to 13,531 vacant properties, a more than 14% reduction since I took office, and the lowest Baltimore's had in 20 years. Last December, we joined with GBC and Bill to announce our historic vision to put $3 billion forward over the next 15 years to finally eliminate vacants once and for all. This vision includes $300 million from the city of Baltimore, the largest investment in our neighborhoods ever. I want to thank Commissioner Kennedy and Director Moxon for leading the charge in developing this strategy that combines city, state, philanthropic, and private funding. And thank you to Governor Moore, Secretary Day, and their teams. It's great to finally have partners on the second floor in Annapolis committed to this strategy. And the strategy is so good that others are copying it and calling it their own. The vision we put forward in December will make us the first city in the United States to issue non-contiguous TIF bonds targeted at vacant properties. Council President, you can expect that legislation for uptown TIFs on your desk this summer. As I quoted during that announcement, I went to the Bible, Isaiah chapter 61, verse 4, and it tells us, "Then they will rebuild the ancient ruins. They will raise up the former devastations, and they will repair the ruined cities, the desolations of many generations." And that's what we all will do together. Baltimore deserves bold leadership that never shies away from a challenge and sets a vision for what this city can be. This is a once-in-a-lifetime plan and a golden opportunity. This job requires a lot of hard choices. But on the day I took office, I promised that I will always do what is right, not what is popular or politically beneficial for me. I stand by that today and every single day. Next week, I will introduce this coming year's preliminary budget. And as Wiley reported, we were staring down a $100 million deficit. But I'm proud to report that the budget we will put forward completely covers the gap, without furloughing employees, without closing rec centers or fire stations, without cutting city services or turning our backs on the priorities moving Baltimore forward. The results of our hard choices don't include balancing the budget on the backs of the things hardworking Baltimoreans need every day. So many of parts of my administration's vision has been denounced by those pessimistic about Baltimore. Our goal to reduce homicides by 15% was laughed at until last year. when we got it done. And now no one asks me about it anymore. Our school year collaborative was called Doomed to Fail. There's no way you're going to get those kids into jobs. But you all can see the success. Our $3 billion vision to address the vacant crisis has already been called overly complicated and insanely ambitious. Every new project is faced with naysayers who find a reason why it can't get done. But every time, we show them why it can. And hear me when I say this. I don't align with those who are pessimistic about Baltimore and nostalgic for a past that did not work for people who look like me. I align with those who are bullish on Baltimore, and that is always a safe bet. Baltimore doesn't back down from a challenge. We don't give up. We fight for our city. You, my fellow Baltimoreans, are our city's greatest asset, and don't let anyone tell you otherwise. Yes, our vision is ambitious, but that is what this moment demands. I'm fighting for you, and I will do everything in my power to make sure that Baltimore's renaissance benefits all of us. This moment in our city's history calls for a leader that will get things done, a leader that can't be bought, a leader with unshakable integrity built with true Baltimore grit. We've identified how to tackle gun violence in our city, and we're seeing results. We're investing in our young people, and we've delivered more rec centers, more new schools, and more opportunities for them. We stabilized a city government that for nearly 15 years only knew instability and scandal. We brought together unprecedented coalitions to tackle our biggest, most daunting problems. Last year, I proclaimed that Baltimore was back, and the people of Baltimore proved me right every day. Now, we must stay the course and see this effort through. It will be hard. It will be long. But it will be worth it to build a Baltimore that works for every single Baltimorean. Join me in this fight for the future and soul of our city, and show the world how beautiful Baltimore can be. God bless Baltimore, the greatest city in America, and God bless each and every one of you. Thank you.
Right.